This is Raghavi, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Bharat Institute of Higher Education and Research Center. The course offered is Comprehension and Communication Skills in English. The topic we are going to discuss today here is You and Your English, Spoken English and Broken English by G.B. Shaw. So who is this G.B. Shaw? G.B. Shaw is none other than George Bernard Shaw himself. I hope so many of you here listening to this video would have come across this name. Maybe you doesn't know the details about him, but still we remember someone named George Bernard Shaw from literature. Yes, of course, it is our G.B. Shaw, George Bernard Shaw, an Irish playwright, a critic, and a political activist. So how do you call a writer a political activist? That is a question, right? Yes, of course, he was a political activist because all his plays, all his criticism was all about political views, and in most funny way, it was a humorous also. He was a witty person who had knowledge in all areas, and yet he wanted to create an awareness and he wanted to ridicule the government and other personalities in those days, yet he did it in a decent way. He was born in July 26, 1856 in Dublin, Ireland. Yes, he has written almost 60 plays throughout his life. 60 plays is not an easy joke. And he was awarded a Nobel Prize in Literature in the year 1925. You know, he was a Nobel Prize winner, and maybe that is the reason why we know G.B. Shaw's name has been heard somewhere else. He started his life as a critic, where he started to write criticisms about the theater plays where he spent his most of the hours. And maybe that was his inspiration, and he started to write a play by himself. And his first play was Man and Superman, which was a static and which was an amazing play, which has been appreciated by people. And after that, he wrote Pygmalion, and it was adapted into a movie twice. I wonder, and I'm not sure if you have watched the movie, and yet you would be amazed how excellent and how amazing he was in his writing. So some of the famous works of George Bernard Shaw is here, as you can see, Man and Superman, written in the year 1903, and Major Barbara in the year 1905, Doctor's Dilemma 1906, Pygmalion 1912, Androcles and Lion 1912 again, St. John 1923, and the last one is Apple Cart 1928. So the Apple Cart is an amazing example of his wit regarding the political views. If you get a chance, take a look at least about the summary of the Apple Cart. It will be interesting, and you may wonder how can one pass on comments on the political views just like that without harming them. There will be too many funny ideas, too many funny incidents taken place in Apple Cart, which could also be serious, but the way he writes it, the way he delivers his ideas will always be humorous. That is why Bernard Shaw is always remembered. Now, let us move on to the prose part. What do you see and what do we discuss in You and Your English, Spoken English and Broken English prose? This is actually a prose. This is a speech delivered by George Bernard Shaw, and it was delivered in a Linguaphone Institute where they wanted this as a recording in a gramophone. So you may wonder, some of them who doesn't have come across this word gramophone, you may wonder what is a gramophone. In nowadays, you would have come across the word, many of you would have seen in applications also the word podcast. Podcast is nothing but similar to blogs. Blogs is different, podcast is different, but this only similar thing is both has one single author and one single owner who can register his ideas and views on single theme. They will be having podcast will be having one single theme, and based on that theme, every day and every now and then they can register their views and ideas about that particular idea. And in those days, we didn't have technologies as we have today. In those days, even a gramophone was considered to be a greatest technology. It was an invention, of course. In nowadays, gramophone is like an antique. We can see that in our grandparents' house, maybe in a museum, and it looks like a speaker. And of course, it will have a recording. A disc will be there, and there will be a pointed device to keep on it, keep on the disc, and the music will be playing. And you may have seen this in movies and maybe some web series, something like that, whichever you are familiar with. In some of the English movies and old movies, classic movies, could have come across this gramophone. So one such speech, like a recording, was this particular prose, Spoken English and Broken English. Throughout this prose, Bernard Shaw has expressed his ideas about what is English and what is the difference between the native speaker and what is the difference between the foreign speaker. And he has been tremendously trying to motivate us, the people who are learning English as the second language, of course, us, the foreigners, except the native speakers. Native speakers is nothing but the person who was born in that particular area itself. For example, our mother tongue, my mother tongue is Tamil, your mother tongue is Hindi, Telugu, Marathi, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. So likewise, a person who has born with English as their mother tongue is called as a native speaker. So he has expressed too many ideas regarding what is that native speaker and what is the difference between him and what is the difference between the foreign speakers. So now let us move on to the next slide. And as I told earlier, Bernard Shaw is categorizing the people who are speaking English into two different categories. The first part is the native speakers, and the second one is the foreign speakers. So as I discussed, as I have explained enough earlier, a native speaker is nothing but, it's none other than the person who has born with English as their mother tongue. So now before moving on to the native speaker, let us discuss about what is the origin of English language. So when I raise this question, when someone is asking you the question, or maybe you are the person who is asking the same question, what is the origin of English language? Of course, we may wonder, what is the origin of English language? We may end up with the answer, Britain or Anglo-Saxon. Those who know literature may speak of Anglo-Saxon and British covered area, so many things you can say. But now, when we go deeper into analyzing what is English language, we doesn't know the exact origin of English language at all. So it is often included as a regional language. Why we call it as a regional language? Because whenever we learn a language and when we are trying to learn something new, obviously we will learn it at the fullest. We'll be excellent in it, but still that will have the influence of our mother tongue. Influence of our mother tongue in the sense, in India, let us take in India, there are various regions. There are various people from various states. And even in our institution, we can see students from various parts of the country. And of course, their mother tongue influence will be there even when they are speaking in English. Why? Because all through our life, from the birth till now, as you are studying in this college, you have come across only your mother tongue. You are trying to learn a language. You are just putting an effort to learn something new from another language, English. So it is considered to be a regional language since it is having the influence of your mother tongue. And then what is the next thing we can find in English languages? It is difficult in pronunciation. Pronunciation is difficult. Of course, it is difficult because in English language, even though only 26 alphabets are there, there are 44 sounds in it. What is the what are those 44 sounds? How do we learn all those things? Of course, we do learn. When comparing to the native speakers, it is us who is learning from the scratch, from the beginning. And that is the first barrier in learning a language. So it is difficult to learn pronunciation. Unless until you are learning pronunciation, it will be difficult for us to understand what other person is speaking to us. This is what we have been taught all through your life. Now we think that we are so bad. When we are asking, when an opportunity is given to you, when a teacher is asking you to present yourself in front of everyone, the first thing strikes our mind is we'll be afraid of speaking in front of everyone. afraid in the sense, it's not like you don't know English, or it is not like you are so poor in English, nothing like that. In our brain, almost antonyms and synonyms of so many words right from the beginning, that is from your first standard, whatever words you have learned, everything you have learned after the schooling only. So obviously there are so many vocabularies in your mind. You are just afraid, you are just nervous, anxious, etc., etc. And the next thing, what is the next difficulty you can face in that barrier in languages? You find it difficult to articulate the words. Is nothing but like you know the exact thing. When I'm giving you a topic and I'm asking you, not just I, anybody, any ex, someone is giving you a topic and they are asking you to speak on that single particular topic, what is the first thing comes to our mind is, we get all our ideas in our mother tongue only. It's not a mistake. It happens to everyone. If you wanted to learn the language, you have to start thinking to answer in that particular language, regardless of what language it is. So that is the first advice which I can share with you. And the next one is, what is the third barrier that is stopping you from speaking in English? That is self-doubt. Self-doubt is whether, what will I do if I'm making any mistake? Will the people in front of me laugh at me? And whether I know any vocabulary, will people be impressed with my presentation? All these questions will be coming to our mind when we are about to present. Of course, it is nature. But what we have to do is, you have to overcome the fear, not just to present there, not just to speak yoga, what is it like, come out from your own shell there, but that will be an excellent opportunity and experience for you when you start doing once in your life. When people are appreciating you for speaking good English, you feel better. Why? Because you are learning it so hard. That's why we are getting that satisfaction. Now, moving on to who's a native speaker. So all these origin of language, it's all about opinions, and it keeps on evolving. Informations and data keep on evolving. And based on that, those things were discussed. But native speaker, who is a native speaker? As I told earlier, a native speaker's mother tongue will be obviously English. It can be American English, it can be British English. Even Russians and French people speak English, but their pronunciation and their way of articulating the sentences, pronouncing the words differs. Why does it happen? Because of their mother tongue. I told you, I'm keep on insisting you about this mother tongue issue, because I'll conclude it. That time you'll be getting an idea of it. So now coming to environmental forcing. What do you think this environmental forcing is? Environmental forcing is nothing but when we are surrounded by people who knew the language, when they are continuously speaking in that particular language itself, with or without the knowledge of us, we learn the language. For example, your mother tongue. Again, coming back there. So when your mother tongue is Hindi or Telugu, what happens there is, at home everybody speaks is Telugu. Whoever is coming and meeting you, they speak in Telugu. And when you go out, you meet your relatives, they also speak to you in that particular language. And of course, you get familiar with it. Hence, you become a native speaker. There is no one forcing you to learn the grammatical rules or pronunciation for your native, your mother tongue, of course. Only for other languages, when you are learning another language, we try to learn the pronunciation. We try to learn the exact meaning of the words. All these things happens. Now, moving on to the next point. Not even the native speakers. That is, for example, let us take four Americans are sitting and discussing on some point. And when they were discussing, not even those four people will be sounding the same. That is, for example, if they're pronouncing the word conversation, all four will not be using the same type of pronunciation to spell the word conversation, because they are native speakers, of course. They doesn't know how to pause or how to stress or something like that. They are not taught from the scratch. They are just obtaining it by nature. So obviously, they will not sound alike in the sense, they won't be sounding similar. There will be, of course, difference from one person to another. That is why George Bernard Shaw is telling to us that no native speaker pronounces the simplest words, no R, S in similar sound. It's true. In English, the most common and the most often used words are yes or no. Yes or no. This is the most common word. Even those two words are not pronounced similar by a native speaker. This is the, let us call it as a most agreeable point. Yes, of course, they don't pronounce it the same. Not because they doesn't know. That is the way they pronounce the word itself. But we even learn the phonetic sounds for no and yes also. That is the point George Bernard Shaw is trying to make. And then in general, he classifies our manners into two types. One is company manners and the second one is family manners. That is the way how we are behaving at home and the way we are behaving in public. So he is also giving an example stating his own life. And in that speech, he is expressing about how when we are lacking listening skills and how it lands us in a misunderstanding at home and also at company. Company in the sense like other than home, wherever we go. How we are ending up in a misunderstanding. That is the first thing he is discussing. And for that, he says, you should know how to use a language and at what tone you are supposed to use the language, at what rate of speech. For example, in a minute, how many words you're supposed to pronounce and in what variation you're supposed to pronounce those words. And based on the situation, whether it is an angry situation, whether it is an embarrassing situation, based on that, how to modulate your voice or modulate your language. All these things, one should be aware. This is what George Bernard Shaw is trying to convey. And he's also stating an example for that using his a personal scenario. Here you can see this conversation at home with wife when he mumbles and at speech or in the stage, he's loud and clear. So he's stating an example here. So he's talking about how he is having a conversation with his wife and how he is so loud and clear when it comes to a public speech to us, when he is giving a public speech, like this recording, when how clear and how bold he can be expressing his views. And when it comes to home, he's of course not able to speak in the same mode. It depends on the mood or maybe the situation, what exists at the home also. So he is conveying this in a humorous way. The next point you can see here, Shaw has an excellent humorous wit. Of course he has. In the previous line itself we saw that, and in the following line you will be witnessing it exactly. The conversation between a husband and wife should be like a conversation between a king and a queen. So what does he mean? How does a king speaks to his queen? He never speaks. Most probably they never speak in front of everyone. They have their conversations in private. And that is how we also should have our conversation. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen with all of us. So what he's telling here, maybe we can take it as in a sarcastic way also. He's telling that a king always keeps on commanding their public and even their his subjects, his family, everyone. He has his right. So unfortunately, that doesn't happen with every one of us because nobody is king and nobody is a queen here. So that is why he is expressing his own ideas in a humorous way. So next, we are going to move on to who is a foreign speaker. So now coming to foreign speaker, whom do we call a foreign speaker? It is me, you, and whoever is not a native speaker. That is, whoever is not having English as their mother tongue. We are called as foreign speaker. And as you can see here, they learn the English language as a second language. And they are learning it from the beginning, from the scratch in the sense like, I told you, 44 sounds are there. All 44 sounds, how we are supposed to pronounce it and how we are supposed to transcribe the words, everything we learn from the beginning. So this point is applicable only to the foreign speakers, not to the native speakers. And then, unlike the native speakers are forced to be terrorized with grammar rules. So unlike the native speakers in the sense, the native speakers doesn't require any grammatical rules. They don't have to sit and read grammars. They doesn't want to know what is a phrasal verb, what is a preposition. They get it by nature. They don't have to sit and think, but it's not like that for us. We have to categorize, we have to identify what is the difference between a conjunction, transition words, sequence words, even though the three discourse markers indeed, even though all four has a, we can generalize it like a connective word, they have a difference where and when we are using it. Likewise, we are the person, we are the people who is learning it from the beginning. And the next term. So here you can see that Shah declares the foreigners need not be perfect in speaking English. So what he is telling to us first is, it is not necessary that you must be perfect in your English speaking. This is the first point he is conveying to us in the sense like we the foreigners. According to him, we are the foreigner, right? For him, he is a foreigner, and for us, he is a foreigner. Fine. So now, according to Shah, most of the London speaks imperfect English. He is comparing us along with the population in London itself. He is giving all these ideas to the students, those who are listening to all these speech of him in a gramophone. So you imagine how motivated they will be when they are listening about this, appreciable and motivating speech. So now, if a foreigner speaks perfect English, they may be subjected to being a beggar or a trickster. So he is stating the mindset of a native speaker. When we are attempting, that is when we foreigners, that is you and me, when we are trying to speak in a perfect English, when we wanted to express our proficiency to them, when we show off exact word to say, that is when we try to show off our accent to them, what happens is they take us not as a foreigner themselves. For them, we are always a foreigner only. For those native speakers, we are never equal, and they will imagine that we are some a beggar or maybe some trickster. Trickster in the sense, a con man who is pretending to be someone who they are not. So this is what they will badge us. This is what Bernard Shaw is trying to convey us. And the next thing is, Shaw emphasizes that there is no such thing as perfectly correct English, and there is presentable English, which we call good English. Of course, so here in this point, I wanted to generalize all my, all my teaching to you, because I always insist my students to keep on developing their English, and I ask them to correct their mistakes, but I never insist them that there exists correct English, there exists a wrong English. There is no such thing called as wrong English. There is only good English and bad English. When we are putting too much effort to learn something, and when we are trying to present our ideas in a decent way, in a, a presentable manner to other person, and when they are understanding the meaning of it, that is a good English. That is more than enough. We no need to pretend the accents. We no need to do fake accents. More than learning the accents, the fake accent is the most embarrassing thing. Instead of doing this fake accents, we can at least read the sounds, we can learn the sounds, we can understand how to pronounce them, and we can do it later. So that is the point George Bernard Shaw wants to make through the word good English. And now the next one. In London, Shaw points out that 999 out of every 1,000 people don't speak bad English. Okay, they don't only speak bad English. They are having, it is a continuous sentence. I'm sorry from breaking it. So what he's trying to tell is, out of 1,000, almost 999 people are only speaking bad English. He wanted to motivate us. That is why he's stating this. I'm not here trying to explain you that native speakers are bad and foreign speakers are good. George Bernard Shaw's points are so clear that don't try to pretend. Try to learn, try to be yourself. That's the same thing I'm also trying to convey through this video. And the next point is, they neither speak it correctly nor be understood when it is well spoken. So he has concluded his own points, whole points here. As I told earlier, if we are too perfect in our pronunciation and when we are trying to convey our ideas in a fake accent, maybe, I told you they may consider us as a beggar and also a trickster. And why? Because he's stating in this point that because they doesn't know to speak correctly and also they doesn't understand when it is spoken well. This is the point he is trying to register in our mindset. So the next thing is, he suggests the foreigners to speak with a foreign accent and speak broken English. He says that it doesn't matter whatever accent we have, whatever regional language influence we have, it doesn't matter. Speak in the same language, and that is English without grammar. Let it be broken English. It doesn't matter. It can be lagging grammar. It doesn't matter. Just speak. Just try. That is the point he tries to make here. And then Shaw exhibits a sarcastic comment to motivate native speakers to understand better and the foreigners to keep speaking good English. Yes, of course, the whole idea of this whole speech via that gramophone was nothing but to motivate us to keep speaking and to keep learning English and the native speakers to get a better understanding, to get to move on with the idea that foreign speakers are also speaking good English and there is no correct English and wrong English. This is the point he is trying to make all through his work. And now let us conclude this video, and I'm just summing up all the ideas which we have discussed so far. So George Bernard Shaw suggests us that one must not speak too well, even with cultivated people. So what he's trying to say, state in this point is, even though the people seem to be so civilized, they are so well dressed and they are, a learned person. Maybe they are so intelligent, the way they are presenting themselves is much more appealable to us. We should never speak well in good English to them because they will always ridicule us. So you should never bother about the critics, those who are laughing at us. Even if it is a classroom and people are laughing at you when you are making mistakes, never take it seriously. The one who doesn't know anything, they laugh at us, obviously. That is the point George Bernard Shaw also is trying to give us. And he dispels the fear of foreigners trying to travel to native land and encourages them to continue with their learned good English. So in this point, what I'm trying to convey to you is, first of all, he gave the speech to all those students, those who were listening, almost foreigners, because the first thing when we have in our mind to travel to another country, and particularly when it is an English country, we have the fear of language. How we are going to go and manage that, and how will the people understand you, or maybe you are understanding them. All these million-dollar questions will be there in our mind, and how to overcome all these ideas. This is how we have to overcome. We have to remember that the native speakers will never understand what you say, and you should never give up to learn better English. This is the point George Bernard Shaw is trying to keep to us. And the last one is, George Bernard Shaw says that it is an insult to the native who can't understand his own language when it is too well spoken. So what he's telling is, no matter whether we speak broken English, whether we speak an accent English, an excellent English, whatever it doesn't, regardless of that, what we have to remember through this speech is, it is not actually an insult to us that we doesn't know the language. It is an insult to a native speaker who cannot recognize or who cannot understand his own language when it is spoken too well. Why do we speak too well English? Because we are learning it. And why they are not able to understand learned English? Because they use it in their day-to-day life. Even a beggar in a foreign country speak in English. And here in our country, in any country, they just die so hard to learn this language, since it is an international language. And henceforth, George Bernard Shaw is concluding his speech with giving some few examples. And also, he is also telling them that they should never give up to learn English language with good accent. And he himself states that even he doesn't know the proper pronunciation because he was a native speaker. And hence, this lesson also is ending with colorful meaning and too much of content. There is no correct English, only good English exists. This is the point of his whole speech, and I wanted to insist you again. Thank you.